Well, thank you all very much, first of all, for taking the time to come here. And I also, I really am tremendously impressed and have been for some time that Medline has taken such a position of influence. And I think it's the highest status, really, of our capitalist society when companies do this, and in conjunction especially with Mount Sinai, who I've had the privilege to speak at, or at to whom I have had. We're going to have a little problem with that grammar. I had the occasion to speak to a class of anesthesiologists, and as a matter of fact, it was the only time since my book was published that I was introduced in this fashion. Here is a gentleman named Mr. Nance, who's not from medicine, who has a fantasy about where medicine can go. And I hasten to say, it is not a fantasy. We can actually achieve these things, and we can achieve them very well. But what I want to talk to you today about is basically setting a framework for what you're going to hear the rest of the day, including from Atul and on all the excellent speakers, and Mark Chasten, about the art of the possible, because it is more extensively in your control than you might think. We have this panoply of problems in healthcare, and we all know them. And certainly, there is not even a way that I can tell you with any degree of assurance that we know how many people we are still hurting or killing every year from completely avoidable mistakes. But we know it's a staggering amount. We have problems, though, that get us to the point of being nose down. And you all know this as chief medical officers, as chief nursing officers, and everybody in this room in whatever capacity. I have great awe in facing and realizing what you deal with on a daily basis. But the most important message that I can begin to frame for you this morning, and the most important thing I think you can do, is to raise your sights from these daily battles that you've got and understand that one of the problems that we have had that has been very, very causative, if you will, of our inability to do better in the 10 years, almost 11 years now, since the IOM report kind of slapped everybody in the face. The chief reason is that we have been looking at tactics and not strategies. And we've been looking at tactics and some strategies rather than philosophy. And we've got to raise our sights and take a look at the overall panoply of where we are, where we've come from, and what we have to do to change American medicine. And change American medicine, we must. There is no choice here. It's not just a matter of something Washington wants. It's not just a matter of being driven by a public with zero tolerance, and they do, or I should say, rapidly reaching that point of zero tolerance. I mean, we've got a body politic now that understands that they need to come in the door and start asking questions, even though they don't have the foundation for those questions. Questions about, are you going to hurt me? You know, how many people should I bring in to guard me when I'm in the hospital? We have a very upset body politic. We have a very confused situation, and we have, and this is embarrassing for all of us, and I've been part of you for 21 years. I know I'm not a doctor, and I don't play one on television, but I've been in the community for quite a while. Matter of fact, on television, I've got ABC right down the street. I could fall out of the hotel, roll to the right, and I'd be in our studios for Good Morning America. And I do apologize, because I should have done two things to start with. I should have told you the exits are here, here, and here. And I should have also told you, relax, nobody's crashed. But where we are is a result of having a system that is invested in the status quo to an extent that is embarrassing. Here's what I mean by that. If I waved a magic wand today over New York State or New York City or any American community, including the entirety of our country, and I said I'm going to reduce by 50% the need for doctors and nurses and hospitals, the need for all of you, I would bankrupt every hospital and every doctor and every medical enterprise within 6 months. So what does that say? Not that somebody's sitting around every day saying, how can we keep the population high in our hospitals so we can keep the money flowing? But in effect, we have a system that is not in any way, form, or fashion invested in the health of Americans, in us. It is invested in keeping everything pretty much on the same status quo level, and that translates in an embarrassing fashion to keeping people about the same level of illness, the same level of need for medicine. Nobody wants this. No one designed this system. We've got to redesign it. George Halverson, head of Kaiser Permanente, a number of years ago in California, I think said it better than anyone else when he said, we do not have a healthcare system in the United States. We have a great non-system. It's full of incredible parts and incredible brilliance and wonderful people, but we do not have a system. That is our call, to make a system out of it. And every one of you and every one of your hospitals, whether you're one of the 38% with just one hospital or whether you're the rest of the list that Sue was talking about who have more than one under your charge, the problem is not only this overall philosophy, but how do we just get a handle on the things that we know we need to do? The ventilator-associated pneumonias, the CAUTIs, the things that Medline, for instance, has been a leader in trying to help stop. Things that we know that if you do A, you get a result B. How do we get the docs on board? UCMOs have got this battle in your face all the time. We've got a physician community, and I've been saying this for the last year. I expect somebody was probably going to put a bomb in my car, but it hasn't happened yet because I think everybody knows I'm right. We have trained every physician, even up to the graduating class of 2010, for the wrong century. And it wasn't the 20th. We've trained them for the 19th century. This is not a pejorative. This is not a slap. We've trained doctors to be that one individual out there on the prairie at 2 a.m. in the morning taking care of a patient. There is no telephone. There is no desk reference. There is no helicopter to come get your patient. It's only you and anything that you know as a physician or don't know. That's the only thing standing between that patient and oblivion. That's how we've trained every one of our doctors. We have done nothing, really, except the very beginnings. Mount Sinai has been one of the sponsors of changing these things over. Jefferson Medical has been one of the few of saying, you know, we've got to train people to be able to operate within, no pun intended, operate within a hospital, which is a collection of fine professionals that you've got to be able to interface with on something other than the king says and everybody does. We have made very, very little inroads into, or very few inroads into this, and this has got to be the future of medical school, and it's got to be the future of training for every doctor in the country. Right now, we're doing remedial training, and every CMO in this room, you know exactly what I'm talking about. The times that you have to take a very fine doctor and pull him over the transom, or her, and try to get him to understand that this is a team sport. This is not an individual situation the way they were taught. It is not a matter of you're the only one who determines what the community standard is. These are the battles you're fighting. Nurses, I spend a lot of time with nurses because I'm married to one. I should tell you, Kathleen Bartholomew, we've kept our professional name. She's the author of the book, Ending Nurse-to-Nurse Hostility, Why Nurses Eat Their Young in Each Other. So I am very well versed in a lot of the things that on a daily basis UCNOs have to do and have to put up with. And as you well know, one of the biggest problems is horizontal hostility, and it's also a feeling of total overwhelmed inability to look at anything new. Also, of course, I think another problem that you all share is nurses are the kings and queens of workarounds. And for those of you in the room who don't understand what I'm talking about, which would be nobody, I've never seen a group of professional people who could find a problem at 11 a.m., create a workaround by 11:15, inculcate it in the shift by 11:30. By 12, it's now been spread to everybody else on the floor. By 1 p.m., no one even questions it, and by time for report, it's just a standard procedure. And our problem is we don't even know what workarounds we have. It's a very, very difficult thing to look at this and say, well, okay, where are these differences between tactics and strategies? We are so nose down in the tactics, it's been hard to look at the strategies. And one of the strategies is, unfortunately, to understand how little you have the opportunity to know about what is really going on. And this is not a pejorative either. This is not saying you're not doing your job. You're struggling to do your job all the time. You're struggling to find out what your docs are thinking for the CMOs and for the CNOs, what your nurses are thinking and doing, what they're working with, what they don't have. This is a monster problem.